Good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Suranjit Barua from Guwahati. On behalf of Northeastern Diabetes Society, I welcome you all to this webinar on COVID-19 and diabetes. This is a small effort of the society to keep the academic activities on a move at this crucial hours of pandemic. My heart is with my fellow colleagues who are frontline warriors fighting hard against COVID-19 at present. I sincerely offer my gratitude to all of them. As you all know, COVID-19 has made a havoc worldwide since its outburst in the Wuhan city of China in December 2019, causing a threat to the mankind, and India is not spared too. Till date, 35 lakhs people got infected and almost 2.45 lakhs people died worldwide in India. Worldwide. In India, approximately 40,000 people got infected and around 1300 plus people died of the disease till now. This is the Wuhan city fish market from where it was said that the disease has started. After that, COVID-19, the lockdown phase has gone in the Wuhan city, and the city become a dull, which was a very vibrant city before. So this is the look of the city after lockdown. This lockdown phase now has adopted by all other countries in the world and still going on in India. This is the background. Actually, in China, 2019, group of people from the seafood and live animal market in Wuhan got pneumonia. Then few of them become very sick, and these sick people's family members also got affected. And the healthcare workers who treated those sick people also got affected. And there are clusters of pneumonia cases in China. Previously, this virus was unknown. So in CDC has named it in 2019 novel coronavirus, and it has started from Wuhan city in December 2019. As the previous pandemics in 2002, we have SARS, which was said to be civet cats, got infected. In March, it was camel, and in 2019, it was said that bats and pangolins are infected, the source of infection. This was the site of origin, Wuhan city, China. The Wuhan wet markets, which were blamed for this COVID-19 infection worldwide. But behind the screen, there were human cry also for the virus, whether it is man-made or in laboratory produced virus, or it is normal virus, it is still in debate. But as you see, Wuhan Institute of Virology is only 20 miles far from human seafood market, and it uses a very sophisticated lab. So you never know what comes after some days or sometimes. So whatever it may be, this COVID-19 is a challenge to the medical fraternity, and we have to work hard to combat this disease. To discuss this dreaded disease and its impact on diabetes, today we have three eminent speakers of Northeastern region among us. The first speaker, Dr. Noni Gopal Sinha, is a consultant physician from Digboi, the far easternmost town of the Assam. He is a prominent academician of the region. He will be speaking on epidemiology, clinical features, and diagnosis of COVID-19. Dr. Sinha will be followed by Dr. Sanjeev Medhi, consultant physician and diabetologist of Sanjeevani Hospital, Guwahati, a well-known speaker who also has past memorable experience of working in Army Medical Corps as a specialist doctor. He will be talking on one of the most important part of the disease, that is the treatment of COVID-19. After Dr. Medhi, the last speaker is Dr. Mukut Roy. He is the endocrinologist from Agartala, presently professor, Department of Medicine, and in charge of endocrine clinic, Tripura Medical College, Agartala. He will be dealing with diabetes in COVID-19. After his talk, we'll have a session on question and answers. I request all the participants to write down their questions in the space provided and to send to us so that our speakers can take one by one. With this word, I invite the first speaker, Dr. Noni Gopal Sinha, to go ahead with his talk. Dr. Noni Gopal Sinha, please.
My slide is here. Is my slide here?
Yeah, yeah.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you all are doing fine. And first of all, I'd like to convey my thanks to the NASS, especially Dr. Suranjit Burwa, for giving me this opportunity. Now, straight to my topic, I'll be talking on epidemiology, clinical features, and 19. And my initial part introduction already given by our moderator, Dr. Suranjit Burwa. And so by this time, we know that the cluster of pneumonia in Wuhan city in the China in the end of December was the Beta coronavirus. And just I'm running very fast. And the WHO in the January 12th named it to be novel coronavirus 2019. The 11th February, the WHO as a coronavirus 2019 is sought by COVID-19. The March 11, 2020, WHO declared to be a pandemic. And after, we all know that it rapidly involved almost all part of the globe except the Antarctica. In India also, we have the first is in the Kerala in the January 13, 2020. This is today's data, almost 35 lakhs people globally affected, and almost 2.5 lakh people have been died. And the US is the most affected country, and more than 11 lakh people and more than 65,000 deaths. And the United States is the most affected country with 33%, followed by Spain, Italy, France, and Germany. And if you see that party cases globally from this chart, we can understand that every day in the last 10 days or 15 days, more than 25,000 globally. And this is today's Indian scenario, we are almost touching 40,000 and 1,300 deaths. And in the new cases per day in the last 2 days, we have crossed 2,000. And the daily death, yesterday was the highest in the May, which is past 200. And usually, in the last, it is in the range of 60 to 70. Now, the structure of the coronavirus is single stranded. They have a crown-like appearance under the electron microscope, so the name is a spike protein. This is a cross-section view of the coronavirus. There are seven types of coronavirus, and the major are caused by the and respiratory problem caused by these three. And we know that MERS, we got it pandemic in 2012, first in 2002, and right now presently we are dealing with this COVID-19. And this coronavirus is around elliptical and often pleomorphic in size. The size is around 60 to 140 nanometers. And if you look at the case fatality rate, I think COVID-19 is relatively quite low. It's 3.4% in comparison to the SARS, which is 10%, and the MERS is around 34%. This COVID 3.4% also may not be a true picture, because we know thousands of asymptomatic patients are there. If you take those into account, probably this rate, this percentage will be less, and we should be hope for the best. The lower the percentage, the better for us. And how contagious this disease is, and which can be reproduced with the R0 ratio. And if you compare the other viruses like measles, it is around 15, COVID it is 2.8, SARS it was 3. That means one index test can infect 3 more persons. And in the early part of the April, the CDC has put a figure of 5.7 to be a R0 ratio. And if you can reach R0 ratio less than 1, it means that the transmission will die out. The spread of the COVID, stage 1, 2, 3, 4, imported local transmission, community transmission, epidemic, I'm not going in detail. This is the slide which I'd like to take you all into, to take your attention, because you can see, this is the slide, who are the people at the most risk of death from the COVID disease. And you can see in the left side, this is the age, and you can see below 50, less than 1% people are dying of the COVID. As the age advances, more than 60 to 16, around 60 to 69, the mortality is around 3.6, and around 70 to 79, it is around 8%. Once it crosses 80, around 14.8, so much so high. Similarly, if there is an underlying condition, like cardiovascular disease, the mortality is 10.5, in diabetes, 7.3, in like chronic respiratory disease, hypertension, and cancer, it is around 6. So how does the transmission occur? And primary route is done in aerosolized droplets produced by coughing, sneezing, and talking. The this viability of SARS coronavirus 2 in aerosol is about 3 hours, but in a special situation where nebulizing, aerosol producing maneuver like nebulizing, 6 hours, there can, this virus can survive on the surface of paper like 3 hours, cardboard 24 hours, glass 4 days, etc. And droplets typically do not travel more than 6 feet. The other possible mode of transmission is from the fomite. If the infected surface like doorknob, etc. is touched, and there can be, a person can be infected through the mucous membrane of the mouth, nasal cavity, and the eye. And nosocomial transmission is an important source of infection in the healthcare personnel. And although there is a 9 in the pregnant lady in the Wuhan city, there are 9 COVID cases are detected, but it's not confirmed article transmission. And also the virus is detected in the stools and infected water, but the transmission also. So what is the case fatality rate? Case fatality rate usually varies from 0.2 to 7%, depending upon the age, comorbid conditions, 2 to 7%, and India, we are around 3.2%. And most of the death during the occurs 2 to 8 weeks of the COVID disease. And the most cause of the mortality in the COVID disease are because of the respiratory disease, around 50%, and around 33% is because of the respiratory plus the myocardial damage or the heart failure, the 5 and the 7% because of the myocardial injury or the cardiac failure, and the 7% it is usually no. This schematic diagram of the spike protein, and which is responsible for this virus to bind to the receptor AC2 of the host. And this is the envelope protein, which is the essential for the pathogenesis of the coronavirus. Just one slide on the how this virus enters to the cell. There is an attachment of the spike protein to the AC receptor of the host, which is most stable in the lung, intestine, heart, heart, and which is held by the TMPRSS2 receptor, and which causes cleavage of the AC2 inhibitor and the activation of the spike protein. This activated spike protein and the cleaved AC2 receptor, this facilitates entry of the cells inside the entry of the virus inside the cell. Also, that is helped by this TMPRSS2 receptor, which adapts the cell to accept the inside the cell. So, who are the higher risk to develop severe illness of the COVID patient? I told the age more than 65 and older, people who live in the nursing home or the long-term care facility. Also, the high-risk condition includes the severe obesity, irrespective of age, BMI more than 49, and other medical conditions like uncontrolled diabetes, renal failure, liver disease, people with the chronic lung disease, moderate to severe asthma, severe heart disease, immunocompromised people, and the patient on the immunosuppression therapy. And ideally, the pregnant women, they should be they're most susceptible to viral infection, but in case of COVID, till now, it has not been shown like that. In the clinical features, what is the incubation period? Incubation period is 2 to 14 days, and in the median is around 5 days. And the average hospitalization days is 7 days from the onset. In terms, it can affect the all ages, and it's really seen that younger age are the incidence is less. In China, around 2%, less than 20 years. Whereas in South Korea, in the same age group, it is around 6.3%. Pneumonia is the most frequent serious manifestation of the infection, characterized primarily by the fever, cough, and dyspnea. And this is a pooled analysis of 181 confirmed COVID cases, estimated incubation period of COVID-19. From this study, what has been shown that median incubation period is around 5.1 days. And less than 2.5% people are affected within 2 days of exposure, and 98% are show symptoms within 12 days of the contact. So the CDC recommends 14 days of active monitoring. But I like to take the attention of all of the audience that there is a note that 101 out of every 10,000 cases will develop symptoms after the 14 days. So 14 days of quarantine, but it is not very rare to get a few cases after 14 days also, according to this study. In the COVID, actually, according to the body's response and the COVID presentation can be divided into three stages. So stage one, early infection, stage two, pulmonary phase. That can be subdivided into stage 2 and 3, and stage 3 is hyperinflation space. And we all know by this time, we're accustomed with the term cytokine storm, and which sometimes is misdirected and causing some hazardous complications to them. And in the stage 1, there will be mild constipation symptoms. Stage 2, in the pulmonary phase, there will be shortness of breath and the hypoxia. And the stage 3 will be presented by the ARDS, thirst, for cardiac failure. And if you look at the spectrum of the disease severity, around 80% people will be around asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic, 15% will be severe, 5% will be critically ill. Out of the critically ill patient, 40 to 60% people may die. Around in the severe cases, the mortality rate is around 8%. In the severe disease, they might mostly present with the signs and symptoms of pneumonia and severe anemia, and the critical disease I already told you, the ARDS, sepsis, or septic shock. And how infective and when these people, infected people, are infectious. And from this slide, you can understand that before the onset of the symptoms, they can be infectious 2 to 3 days prior to their infection, the symptoms. And in the mild, in the asymptomatic cases, they can be up to 14 days. They can be infective, mild to moderate cases up to 3 weeks. In case of severe and the critical cases, they may be infected till the recovery occurs. And the few study have done so, they can be even infective 5 to 7 days after the recovery. So usually the patient presents with a mild cold-like symptoms to severe viral pneumonia leading to ARDS. Once ARDS, they present with tachycardia, tachypnea, and cyanosis. The most common symptoms being fever, dry cough, dyspnea, myalgia, fatigue, sputum production, and the most of the symptom in the 90% people they present with more than, and the lesser symptoms they present with. Out of this, I like to mention about the loss of smell, and this is a very peculiar, and they may persist till the end of the till the recovery period, and there may be nasal congestion. Nasal condition, and there may be 40-30% people can affect with the diarrhea, and few studies they have shown that in 10% people diarrhea may be the first initial symptom before having the other symptoms, and they may present only with diarrhea followed by the other clinical features. In the severe cases, there may be confusion, there may be cyanosis, hemoptysis, chest pain, and the features of ARDS. And this is a few parameters I like to mention here. In the mild symptoms, the SPRT will be more than 94%, heart rate will be less than 100, SPRT less than 22, and systolic BP will be more than 90. In moderate cases, there will be tachypnea, SPRT will be maybe less than 94, heart rate will be more than 100, SPRT maybe less than 22 or more than 22, systolic BP might be less than 90. And in the severe cases, the PO2 by FiO2 ratio be less than 300, easily sorting out the conditions. This can be again subdivided into mild, moderate, severe ARDS. And this is the slide which I'm to show that in the ICU person, the striking symptoms, the dyspnea in 92%, whereas in the non-ICU patient is around 55%. And timeline of COVID 19 cases after the onset of illness. In the 41 cases in day one, they have found that average days of admission is 7 days. Around 50% patients develop dyspnea, and around 25% develop ARDS in the 11 days. By 16 days, around 40% patient they need ICU. This is the study from the Northern Italian hospital, and they have shown that around 20% of COVID patients, they might present with dermatological manifest like urticaria, atrial ischemia. There may be diffuse maculopapillarisis, libido reticulitis, vesicular dryness, chickenpox, and the petechiae. So one should make a note of skin also while examining a suspected case. So apart from these, also clinical features also, sometimes the patient may, there are neurological manifestations of like encephalitis, meningitis, and LGB symptoms, or a like stroke. It may be mimicker of the stroke also. So what are the clinical features associated with the fatal outcome? If the patient presents with the dyspnea, if there is a low oxygen saturation, if there is low lymphocyte count, the future predictor of the fatal outcome. And the ICMA has put the guidelines time to time, and you got to follow the guidelines and you get either the isolation of the virus. But we got to keep in the mind of all the history is very important, travel history, and by this time we can understand the clinical features are not very much signs of COVID-19. It can be of any respiratory disease or any infection can be like picture similar to the COVID-19, whatever we have talked right now. So there are a few WHO definitions, suspected case, then I'm not going through the details, that is probable case, and what is the confirmed case? A person with a laboratory confirmation of virus causing COVID-19 infection, irrespective of clinical signs and symptoms, they are said to be confirmed case. According to the ICMR, April 2020, people should be put for this test. They are the all symptomatic individuals who have undertaken intensive travel in the last 14 days. All symptomatic contacts of laboratory confirmed cases, all symptomatic healthcare workers, all sorry patients with other causes not known, and all asymptomatic direct or high risk contacts confirmed case should be tested once within the 5 to 14 days. 14 days, and the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare time to time may put notified like people of hotspots and clusters of the like medicine can be tested, and the all influenza like symptoms should be tested. If they presented within 7 days, they should be tested with the RT-PCR. After 7 days, they should be tested with the rapid antibody test. If then also in the rapid antibody test is negative, they should be repeated by the RT-PCR. Test with the RT-PCR, and this is the site-specific positivity of the RT-PCR chart. We can know that bronchial levels is the highest yielding around 93%, 3%, pharyngeal swab is 32%. But ideally, according to this, we should go for bronchial levels, but this is a risky position, aerosol producing position, more healthcare the chance of not easily available everywhere. This can be taken, this specific are not giving the positivity results, or if the patient is under for some other indications, the bronchoscopy, then bronchial levels can be done with proper, ideally for the community diagnostic and nasal swab is really advocated by the ICMR. And just one slide on RT-PCR, it takes only 4 hours, and in the one machine from 100 to 100 twists in a day. And RT-PCR is can take up the disease in the early part of the disease. It is highly specific, but sensitivity may be as low as 50% to 70%. The test can be done at the point care without any highly trained person. It is cheaper, it is faster, it is negative in the early phase before 7 days, because the IgM starts after 7 days only. Specificity is a big concern. So what is the current recommendation of the RT-PCR as a primary diagnosis of COVID-19? If initial testing is negative, but the suspicion of COVID-19 testing from multiple respiratory sites will antibody test need not to be used, and for safety reasons, specimen of suspected or documented COVID should not be submitted to viral culture or even the other form of culture. If at all necessary, they should be taken with a lot of care. This is, I'm just skipping this slide, and just two slides more. I want to mention about the X-ray and the CT scan. The chest X-ray, sometimes if the patient comes with this type of chest X-ray, this can be not for the diagnostic tool, and any guideline does not recommend chest X-ray and the CT scan to be as a diagnostic tool, CT report, and there may be a lot of confusion in the lower zones, upper zones are not affected. In later period, they may develop the consolidation, and very rarely unilateral relocation is not seen. The CT scan also similar finding damage of pneumonia, but necessary, and this finding when patient comes done for some another reason. If the RT-PCR test for the COVID-19 is not done, we can advise those COVID-19 tests. So this is around, it is a 138 hospitalized patients case report from the Wuhan city, and they have shown in the chest X-ray bilateral lung injuries around 75% of people. And these are the other tests which are done for the risk stratification for the COVID infected. I think in this short to understand, I might be missing a lot of important points. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Nandigopal Singh, for your nice presentation. Next, I'll invite Dr. Chandir Mehdi. to go ahead with his talk on the management of COVID-19. Hello, Siddharth. Do you hear me, Siddharth?
So Sandeep, you slide there.
Siddharth, please check the sound system again.
Sandeep, you slide.
I think Siddharth is playing this thing. Sound is off.
Sanjeev,
I think you can go with the share screen.
Not getting your voice.
Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Sanjeev, have you shared the screen?
I think Sanjeev is ready. I think Mukesh can.
Siddharth.
Dr. Sanjeev, you have to connect your audio, computer audio. Can you please remove your headphones, sir?
I have removed.
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Okay. So, how do I share? My slides are not sharing. I don't know why.
You go with the share screen, I think.
Yeah, now it has come. Now it has come.
We can hear you. Yes, it's visible, sir. Coming. Go on.
It has come now?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please go on.
Am I audible? Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Evening, friends. Welcome once again to the platform of NEDS on a very important topic which we all are discussing, the present COVID virus. As my previous speaker has dwelt upon the clinical features, the epidemiology of the virus, I'll be dealing mainly with the treatment part. The treatment part has got a lot of gray areas. We all know that things are not yet finalized. Trials are going on. I'll try to give you the latest what is happening, but tomorrow the things may change and newer modalities of treatment can arrive. But as of now, what has been there, I'll try to project that much to you all. So we all know that coronavirus is a very has created havoc in this world, and we human beings are still to find a cure to this virus. Dr. Noni has dwelt upon how this virus attacks the human cell by means of the ACE receptors, which are present all over the lungs, the heart, GI tracts, and the kidneys, and gains entry into the cell. And the main proteins which are there are the S proteins and the M proteins. The S is mainly meant for attachment to the virus, and the M protein is mainly meant for transporting the virus into the cell. Now, if you see, once the virus enters the cell, there are two types of responses. One is the primary inflammatory response, and other is the secondary inflammatory response. The primary inflammatory response leads to cytokine release, expression of antibodies, pulmonary infiltrates, vascular permeability increase, lymphopenia, and RAS dysfunction. And the secondary inflammatory response, which kicks in after, say, about 5 to 7 days of the disease, it allows queuing of the macrophages, delayed wound healing, interleukin-8, MCP-1 production, acute lung injury, and cellular damage. It is the secondary inflammatory response is mainly because of the complement activation. And this is the response, which is responsible for all the multi-system dysfunction which occurs in the later part of the disease. But the best part, everything has got a silver lining, but the best part is almost 80% of the patients, they get cured themselves. It's only a 20% which needs some support from the medical fraternity. So, 1 in 6 patients with COVID will be seriously ill and develops difficulty in breathing. 80% of patients will recover from COVID-19 without needing special treatment. So this is the best part of the disease. This virus is highly infective, but the mortality rate is less compared to SARS or the MERS. This slide Dr. Noni has shown before, but I'll be again dwelling on this just to highlight that when we should be active in which part of the disease. In stage 1, which is the very early stage, many of the patients, they don't come to us. Usually the patient comes to us in stage 2, when they develop shortness of breath, hypoxia, difficulty in breathing, and all this sets in. And we have to be very proactive. We have to be very proactive in our approach and pick up the cases which can progress towards the severe disease. Because once the disease goes into stage 3, the chances of mortality becomes very high. If we can pick them up and treat them properly in stage 2 with the available treatment modalities which are there, we can expect a better results in those patients. So we should know, once the patient comes to us, we should know in which stage of disease he is, and we should act accordingly and treat him with the fullest, and there should be no scope of any ambiguity in our treatment. So this is a disease progression which takes place. Day 1 is cough, and usually the patient, as I've told, comes to us around after the first week, say around day 8. In day 10, he develops fever and all. ARDS usually sets in by day 12, aka acute kidney injury and all this by day 15, and death usually occurs by day 19. The best part, the worst part of this disease is that the patient seems to improve and then they rapidly deteriorate. Am I audible?
Yes.
And then they rapidly deteriorate. So it has to be maintained on each and every patient, and on the deteriorating factors, they have to be washed out. And another important thing which needs to be noted is that the patient can recover from the respiratory symptoms, but he can develop sudden cardiomyopathy, and sudden death is a known feature in the later part of the disease. So now coming on to the treatment, we all know that there is no specific treatment for this disease. Social distancing, maintaining a good hygiene level is the most important thing which can be done to prevent the disease. The idiom or like prevention is better than cure holds true for this disease. I will be discussing, because of the shortage of time, I will be discussing just the antivirals and the fewer newer modalities, and the rest we all know what has to be done in social distancing, what has to be done with the fomites and all. So we all know all these things, and I'll be confining myself to the medicine part of this treatment. Coming on to the antiviral therapy, there are many antivirals which are used, but the noted one is remsidavir, lopinavir, ritonavir combination, and fenofibrate, which has been used in Korea and China. Effective therapy is yet to come, but there is a cocktail of medicines which are being tried, and I will try to put it forward to you. The latest molecule which has hit the bandwagon is remsidavir. It's a broad-spectrum antiviral, which is a nucleoside analog prodrug. This drug was developed mainly for Ebola virus, in which it didn't show much response, but it has shown quite a good benefit as far as SARS and MERS virus are confined. Coming on to COVID-19, it has shown some wonderful results. And as of now, it is the talk of the town. It was studied in clinical trials for various virus infections, but show limited benefits. Remsidavir has been shown to inhibit replication of other human coronavirus associated with high morbidity in tissue culture. efficacy in in-vivo models has been demonstrated for SARS-CoV-19. Several phase 3 clinical trials are going on with this molecule in the countries like United States, South Korea, and China. Positive results are seen with remdesivir after use in the University of Washington. This molecule came into focus after travelers of USS of this this boat which came from Japan, this cruise liner, the patients of which got infected, and they were first treated with this remdesivir molecule, and it has shown very good results. And after that, the US FDA gave permission to use this molecule on a selected basis. But the latest development which took place, that yesterday the US FDA has accorded its permission. It is now a US FDA drug for use in COVID-19 virus. So it's a US FDA has granted approval only yesterday to this molecule to treat COVID-19 virus. There are a few trials. The ACT trial, which the results of which were announced on 29th of April, has shown wonderful results. 1,060 patients were treated with this. Preliminary results indicate that the patients received remdesivir had a 31% faster time to recovery than those who received placebo. The median time to recovery was 11 days in patients who were treated with this molecule compared to 15 days who received placebo. Remdesivir, the survival benefit was 8% versus 11.6%, which was numerically less, but it was not statistically significant. So remdesivir is the molecule which is the latest armamentarium in the treatment of COVID-19. The dose which you use is 200 milligram IV stat followed by 100 milligram IV once a day for 5 to 7 days. Coming on to the next combination, this was the combination which was used before the advent of remdesivir, the combination of lopinavir and ritonavir. This combination is usually given with interferon beta. In a randomized controlled trial, open label trial of hospitalized adult patients with confirmed SARS infection having a less oxygen saturation and on a host of ventilatory support, these patients were randomized to this combination of 400 milligram and 100 milligram BID for 14 days. Results have shown that time to clinical improvement did not differ between the two groups. The mortality rate at 28 days was numerically lower for lopinavir / ritonavir combination compared to standard care. So if you see the treatment results of this class of molecule, it is slightly lesser as compared to remdesivir. Remdesivir appears more potent as compared to this combination. But the best part of this combination is it can be used in pregnant ladies. Pregnant ladies who can't take chloroquine or other molecules can be safely given this combination. Nitazoxanide, we all know, is an anti-protozoal drug mainly used for treatment of cryptococcal diarrhea or Anteroba histolytica. This molecule is being evaluated for treatment of COVID-19. Two phase 3 trials are going on and the results are awaited in the United States. The other molecule which is being used, which is being tried, is favipiravir. Mainly it is an anti-influenza drug which is used in Japan. It selectively inhibits the RNA polymerase which is necessary for viral replication. Phase 3 trials are going on and exact results, the effectiveness will be known once the results are out. The dose which you use is 600 milligram stat orally followed by 600 milligram 8-hourly. In the United States, a phase 3 trial will enroll around 50 patients of COVID-19 and we are all waiting for the outcome of this trial. Hydroxychloroquine, the most important molecule, the cheapest, and the molecule really came into fame after Donald Trump applied his stamp to it. And we as Indians should feel proud that we are the largest bulk manufacturer and we have exported this drug to all over the globe. So chloroquine is the least effective and one of the most widely used drug in the treatment of COVID-19. It has been found in vitro that the antiviral activity of hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine is in the lysosomes. What happens is once the virus gains entry into the cell, this chloroquine, it increases the pH of the lysosome. There's alkalization of the pH of the lysosome, as a result of which the replication process of the virus is affected and the virus can't replicate. So once the virus can't replicate inside the cell, it can't propagate, and this is how chloroquine stops the replication of the virus and prevents the development of COVID-19 infection. Few trials are there. One randomized controlled trial was done on a very small number of patients in China, and it has shown wonderful results as far as reduction in fever, improvement of CT imaging features. The Chinese study has really, it's a randomized controlled trial, and it has shown some wonderful results with the use of this molecule. But a larger trial, a multinational trial, more randomized controlled trial is needed to see the exact effectiveness. And the Europeans are also having a lot of mini trials of this molecule, and the results are also awaited. As of now, chloroquine is being prescribed to all the COVID-19 patients, starting from the very mild stage of the disease. Some important trials with this molecule took place in France. The French are the people who really love the combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. Many trials have taken place. And apart from the clinical features, another very important point they found that it decreases the carrier state of the disease. That means the virus disappears from the nasal cavity as early as 7 days with the use of this combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. So once the virus disappears from the nasal cavity by day 7, chances of infectivity to the other people also decreases. So it shortens the disease duration in the patients who are treated with this combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. This has been the results of the French studies, and more larger trials are underway. So what does the Indian government say? The Indian government approves this molecule in the treatment of COVID-19 patients, either severe patients or the mild form of disease. The dose they recommend is 400 mg BD for day 1, followed by 200 mg BD for 4 days, in combination with azithromycin 500 mg OD for 5 days. This is the recommendation of the government of India. This should be administered under close medical supervision with monitoring of side effects, including QTC interval. They are presently not recommended for children below 12 years, pregnant lady, and lactating women. As I've already told, that in pregnant lady, the drug of choice is lopinavir and ritonavir combination. That is a drug of choice in pregnant ladies. Hydroxychloroquine is more effective than chloroquine, and it is also used in prophylaxis. In healthcare personnel, 400 mg twice daily on day 1, followed by 400 mg per week for 7 weeks. And for asymptomatic household contacts, the dose is 400 mg twice a day on day 1, followed by 400 mg once weekly for the next 3 weeks. So this molecule is also being used as chemoprophylaxis to prevent the onset of COVID-19 infection. Another very important molecule is ivermectin. It's an anti-protozoal drug. It's an anti-helminthic drug, we can say. And this drug has really shown some very interesting results. There's reduction in the number of cells associated with the DNA. There is 99% reduction in 24 hours in the viral load with the use of this molecule. A single treatment is able to affect 5,000-fold reduction in virus load at 48 hours. So this is the effectiveness of this molecule. Ivermectin is the drug which needs to be watched out in the future. How it works? It works that during the process process of multiplication inside the body, the coronavirus needs to work with cargo transporter to be able to get into the nucleus. Ivermectin blocks the cargo transporter, hence the virus can't get inside the nucleus and can't make replication in the body. So it blocks the virus entry into the nucleus. And the trial results which are there as of now with this molecule, this is a drug which has shown a wonderful reduction in mortality. The highest reduction in mortality is seen with ivermectin. It has got a p-value of 0.0004. No other drug has shown this much of reduction in mortality apart from ivermectin. But the dose which you use is 150 microgram per kg body weight for 24 hours. It's a very high dose. It is a very high dose, and in this high dose, side effects are very common. So that is the only point of concern. So that is being worked out. Trials are going on. So this is a molecule which needs to be watched out in the future. So in a summary, slide, in this slide, it's a very busy slide. I am just showing you all the molecules which are being used. That is chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, remdesivir, ribavirin. Ribavirin is no longer used in a very large scale. Lopinavir, ritonavir, duranavir, cobicistat. These are being used in the USA, this combination. Unifenovir was being used in Japan, but results are not very encouraging. Favipiravir is being tried. Trial results are awaited. It's a Japanese molecule. This is also a molecule which can be given in combination with lopinavir and ritonavir combination. We can give a cocktail of antiviral, but a point to be noted, it not more than 3 antivirals should be given to a COVID patients. So another very important combination is the combination of lopinavir, ritonavir plus favipiravir. So these 3 can be given in specific cases. Interferon is a drug which is used with other antivirals. It is used to control the cytokine storm. And the aerosolized form of interferon alpha is also being used to control the cytogenic storm dysfunction which occurs in the lung tissues. Tocilizumab is a monoclonal antibody. It's an interleukin-6 inhibitor. It blocks the cytokine storm and has been found to be very effective if used in the right dose and in the right time of the patient's disease stage. So these are the recommendations of various international bodies. Very busy slide. I will just confine myself to the Chinese and the Korean. The Chinese use chloroquine 500 mg BD for 10 days. In moderate case, they give lopinavir, ritonavir combination plus hydroxychloroquine in moderate cases. In severe cases, they are recently shifting on to remdesivir. If you see the Italian society's recommendations, Italy has got a huge chunk of COVID patients. They have treated the most number of patients, I must say. And they use the combination of lopinavir, ritonavir plus chloroquine in the mild to moderate case. In the mild case, they use chloroquine only. And in the severe cases, they use, recently they have started off with remdesivir also. But the best combination, which I found, is the European bodies. The other European bodies, like the Belgium Society, they have come out with very good results. In mild to severe cases, they use hydroxychloroquine in the dose which I told you, 400 milligram twice a day on day one, followed by 200 milligram BD for 4 to 5 days. Those who can't take this can be given lopinavir ritonavir combination for BD dose for 14 days. If hydroxychloroquine can't be tolerated or is contraindicated, we can go in for this combination of lopinavir ritonavir plus favipiravir can also be added to it. In critical patients, remdesivir, of course, has to be given 20 milligram loading dose, followed by 100 milligram OD for 2 to 10 days. A very recent trial found that a dose of 5 days is equally effective as a dose of 10 days of remdesivir. But there is no one single miracle drug for COVID-19. We have to give a combination of antivirals, monoclonal antibodies, and a cocktail of medicines if you really need to take care of the patients. Coming on to the corticosteroids, this is a very gray area. How to use this molecule, what is the dose, when to be given, there is no precise definition as of now. But what I found out after reading many literatures is that there are a few indications where we can use these corticosteroids. First of all, it has to be used in severe and critical patients. Second, if the temperature is more than 39 degrees Fahrenheit. Third, if the interleukin 6 count is more than 5 times the upper level of normal, interleukin 6, I am saying again, interleukin 6 count is more than 5 times the upper level of normal. Third, if the patient has 30% of bilateral lung involvement in the form of ground glass appearance, or if there is 50% increase in the lung infiltrate in 48 hours, the patient needs to put on corticosteroids. So these are the indications where we must use corticosteroids along with the other antivirals, which I have told. The corticosteroids which are used is methylprednisolone. The dose is 0.75 to 1.5 milligram per kg body weight. Usually, in the initial part, we give 40 milligram IVOD. If there is no improvement, we can increase it to 40 milligram IVBD. We can even go to 80 milligram IVBD in severe cases. How long it has to be given? It has to be given till there is improvement in the markers of the patient, clinical features of the patient. And once there is stability of in 3 to 5 days, we can reduce the dose by half and slowly taper it down. So corticosteroid can be given in the form of methylprednisolone in the indications which I have told, like severe and critical patients, hyperpyrexia more than 39 degree, interleukin 6 more than 5 times the upper level of normal, lung infiltrate more than 30% bilaterally, or if there's 50% increase in the lung infiltrate every 48 hours, the patient needs to be put on corticosteroids. The interleukin 6 inhibitor, sarilumab, has been tried with not much good results. Teclizumab is the molecule to be watched upon. It is given in the dose of 400 milligram IV stat once a day, two to three doses usually does the trick. It is given in a OD dosing. Again, it has to be given in severe patients, critical patients, to prevent the manifestation of cytokine storm. Convalescent plasma, we all know, is the talk of the town. India government is also trying, and many trials are going on. This form of therapy was first tried in diphtheria, and then many other viral diseases like Ebola, MERS, and SARS also have been tried with this form. As far as COVID-19 is concerned, trials are going on. Some patients have shown good results, but exact recommendation is yet to come. Usually, it has to be given before 3 weeks, because after 3 weeks, the patient starts developing his own antibody. But the caveat is that it has shown benefit even in patients more than 3 weeks old. The patients from whom it has to be collected are the patients who are virus, RT-PCR negative patients after 2 weeks of improvement. It means patients who are healed for 2 weeks, who are virus negative in their testing again, the plasma can be collected from them. Usually, 200 to 400 ml of plasma is collected, and the plasma needs to be checked again for the virus, a RT-PCR needs to be done before transfusing it to the patient. And once it is RT-PCR negative, 3 ml of the plasma needs to be kept in the laboratory to see the neutralizing effect in 1:320 dilution. We can't measure the IgG level or the IgM level in the plasma accurately. So we do neutralizing test with the plasma in the dilution of 1:320 to see the effectiveness of the plasma. Usually 200 to 400 ml is infused into the patients, and repeat dosing is being given depending upon the improvement which is seen in the patient. The FDA states that it's important to determine its safety and efficacy via clinical trials before routine administration of convalescent plasma to patients with COVID-19 is administered. So this is a gray area. Trials are going on. Some patients have shown wonderful results, but thing is, the door is wide open. Nitric oxide inhaled form is being given by aerosol or by nebulization to reverse the pulmonary hypertension and the pulmonary defects, damage which occurs in the COVID patients. It has shown some wonderful results. Trials are going on. So this is in a table form of the various treatment which we use. If you see from day 1 to 7, chloroquine is the drug of choice. Hydroxychloroquine is more effective than chloroquine. If the patient progresses to the pneumonia stage, hydroxychloroquine plus lopinavir, ritonavir can be given. Or if the clinician feels that the disease is progressing very fast, he can go in for remsidavir also. If the patient goes into the severe shock stage or the critically ill patients, we need to give a cocktail of hydroxychloroquine, remsidavir, interferon beta 1, steroids, and tocilizumab. So this is the combination which is being tried in the world as of now. In critically ill patients, we give a cocktail of hydroxychloroquine, remsidavir, interferon beta 1b, steroids, and judicious use of tocilizumab can be given. So this is, in a nutshell, the various stages of the disease and which molecule to be used in which particular stage. My previous speaker has dwelt upon all these who patients are. I just have to highlight again, the patients with cardiovascular disease have the highest mortality, followed by diabetes, followed by chronic respiratory disease. These patients need to be checked in from the very beginning, and we have to be very proactive and watch these patients carefully. The current CDC definition of high-risk patients, more than 65 years old, living in nursing home, chronic lung disease, serious heart disease, people of any age with severe obesity also needs to be kept under the lens. So once we find out the high-risk patients, and we should be very proactive in those high-risk patients in our treatment with the armamentarium which I have discussed with you all. Thank you, everyone, for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev. So we'll come to the question session at the last. So I invite the next speaker, Dr. Mukut Roy. Dr. Mukut Roy, please go ahead with your presentation. Dr. Mukut Roy, please.
Yeah, I'm just starting. So is the slides visible now?
No, not.
Really.
Siddharth, could you help him, please? Siddharth, do you hear me?
Dr. Mukut, you have to go to share screen. Share screen and open your slides and share screen.
That's what I want.
You remove your air plug, then only it happens. Once the air plug is there, this will not work. Disconnect it.
fine. You open the slide. You go for the slide.
Slides, sir. Slides can be seen?
Not yet.
Sir, I will share your slide, sir.
Okay.
We will do the share screen. You can just go read.
Yeah, now it's...
Okay, then.
It has come, yes. You can go ahead.
So, yeah, good evening, everybody. At the outset, I must sincerely thank and congratulate NEDS for taking this initiative on this hot topic, which is definitely needs to be addressed. And my assigned topic today has been chosen as diabetes in COVID-19. To start with, whether our patients of type 2 diabetes are really more likely to get COVID-19? That's a big matter of questions to us. And as of now, we can see that definitely the diabetic patients, the data says that they are more likely to experience severe symptoms. And globally, it has been proved that people with diabetes have much higher rates of serious complications than people without diabetes. Next slide, please. So again, if we go back, we can say that if the diabetes is well managed and well controlled, the risk of getting severely sick from diabetes is almost about the same as the general population. Of course, it depends on multiple factors like availability of the medication, then hygiene of the injection sites, accessibility of the healthy foods, how is the mental health happening, and what about the glucose monitoring, healthcare, and the access to adequate amount of fluids, intake of proper fluids, intake of proper complex carbohydrate, and altogether a complete management of the lifestyle. Next slide, please. So if we can see the close relationship, am I audible? If we can go with the thing, is there any really any relationship exists between diabetes, whether we can see the type 1 or type 2 diabetes and different viral form of pneumonias, which in fact initiated from the 2003, where the SARS epidemic was started. And there also it has been seen that it was around 3.1 times higher in diabetic patient than in the non-diabetic patient. And the almost similar picture came in 2009 with H1N1 outbreak, where again the diabetic were more prone to develop this form of disease. And in the Middle East respiratory syndrome in 2014, again confirmed this similar data. Next slide, please. So if at all, any potential mechanism, because our previous two speakers, they have nicely demonstrated different pathophysiology and different metal mechanism, how the COVID-19 enters to our body, using the SE2 receptor, and also the involvement of the TNPRSS2 receptor. So what I found interesting is that patients with diabetes definitely have bad glycemic control after the viral infection. That is there. So contrary to the finding also, the blood glycemic control, again, may predispose to the risk of different viral infection due to the reduction of the immunity, as we know. So the LC2 receptor, which is a functional receptor for the SARS virus, their expression has been seen in the exocrine and endocrine tissues of the pancreas, which suggests that probably this virus may cause further damage to the pancreatic islets. If we go with this study of 385 patients infected with the SARS-CoV virus, then it has been seen that probably the pancreatic islets destruction also had an important factor for the increased mortality in poorly controlled type 2 diabetes patients. Next slide, please. And so because of the constraint of time, I'll straight away go with the management. And if we think about the diabetes in COVID-19, they may not live in close proximity, but depending on the situation, probably they come in the close proximity. And again, definitely the importance of social distancing comes in the close proximity. But therefore, the management probably may not be that difficult if we follow the definite protocol. So we can see that there appears to be two reasons for this. Firstly, the immune system is compromised, which predisposes a reduction of the effects of the macrophages and others, and therefore the immune system compromising and harder to fight the virus and likely leading to a definitely longer recovery period, of course, those patients really recovers. Secondly, the virus get a positive environment for them to thrive with an elevated blood glucose level. Next slide, please. So what should be our advice, a common advice to the patient when to contact a doctor? Because of this lockdown phenomena, and even after the exit of the lockdown phenomena, many patients may be afraid to come to us. And so there we should have an option for online consultation if possible. And we can give them an idea regarding how to manage this in a better way and in a simplified way. And they should come with all these few points where if they have gotten the episodes of repeated vomiting, or they come with the different symptoms of diabetic ketoacidosis, like the features of vomiting, rapid breathing, abdominal pain, or reduced level of consciousness, definitely they should not treat themselves at home and they should consult a doctor. Next slide, please. So therefore, we have to give and contact information of the healthcare provider, ideally to a patient or the patient caregiver. And if this phases continues, and if this phenomenon continues, probably they need to have an adequate stock of medication and supplies for monitoring blood glucose in the form of glucometers, or in the form of necessary drugs, or in the form of enough amount of oral glucose or simple sugars to manage the hypoglycemia. Accordingly, many of the educated patients may use the glucagon or ketone strips in case of poor glycemic control. Next slide, please. So there I want to emphasize on the what we give advice to an insulin dependent patient or in type 1 diabetes patient as sick day rules, where we give them a simple advice to keep themselves hydrated with intake of enough amount of fluids, to monitor their blood glucose as per the requirement as given by the physician or diabetologist or endocrinologist. Accordingly, they must also check the temperature, which can give us a clue regarding the COVID-19 and its severity. Definitely, if they are on insulin and if there is risk for diabetic ketoacidosis, they also should monitor their ketone bodies in the form of urine for ketone bodies. And ideally, they should consult and have a regular discussion with their healthcare team. Next slide, please. So if we combine these different factors, we can try to understand in a simplified way what are the reason of glucose fluctuation in patients with diabetes and COVID-19, where we can see that definitely the pattern of irregular diet, irregular exercise, and GI symptoms may be one of the important factors. Definitely the co-infection with COVID-19, which is an extremely stressful condition, which may increase the level of the counter-regulatory hormones in the form of the cortisol. Then again, few of the patient in the isolation wards or those who are staying at home due to the inavailability of the OIDs, there might be results of glucose fluctuation. There also, it has been seen that there is mental outbreak, mental exhaustion, and increased psychiatric problem, which may also fluctuate the blood glucose level. And on top of that, As our previous speaker has discussed, that COVID-19 can cause a huge cytokine storm-like syndrome in severe and critical patients co-infected with COVID-19 and diabetes. Next slide, please. So if we go with a target-oriented blood glucose control, I think if we can see that those who are in the high-risk patient or those who are inpatient, we can go for a stricter glycemic control. And those who are staying at home and having low or medium dose, low risk, that in that case, we can go for a bit less stringent glycemic control. Next slide, please. So what should be our guidelines for the people, those who are suffering from type 1 diabetes? Definitely, we have to give them an advice, that a simplified advice, that insulin cannot be stopped for a single day, or at least it has to be continued till the time that this condition happens and continues. So therefore, sometimes you may need to increase the dose of insulin, or the units. The dose, of course, depends on a glycemic level and after consultation of the doctors. And therefore, ideally, the blood sugar level should be in between 110 to 180 milligram per deciliter. Next slide, please. So, yeah, this is a slide. So this is a slide what I have shown. Is the slide from IDF where it has been seen that the different blood glucose level and the monitoring of the blood glucose and the increment of the dose. Accordingly, we can also opt for different other guidelines like ADA or ASC guidelines to increment the dose of the insulin depending on the blood sugar level, and those who are having associated increased ketone levels, we can also add on to that. Next slide, please. So what should be our advice and what should be our plan of action? Those who are type 2 diabetes patients on oral antidiabetic agents. And in that case, if the patient having persistent infection in the form of other infection or having vomiting or having dehydration, then ideally we should take out the metformin tablet and SGLT2 inhibitors. Again, the blood glucose target remains in between 110 to 180 milligram per deciliter. And as they are having low risk and on OAD, having not much symptoms of COVID-19, they can monitor for the blood glucose level at least twice a day. Next slide, please. But having said that, this is a gray area, and definitely insulin remains the safest choice under most circumstances, which can be considered as a superior alternative even with type 2 diabetes patients, those who are already on OAD but having poor glycemic control. So although I will go with the mechanism that there is no direct effect on SC2 is reported, but it has been seen that in my studies, insulin treatment has been shown to attenuate renal ADAMS 17, which is a disintegrin and metalloproteinase 17. So in normal physiology, ADAMS 17 cleaves SC2, thereby inactivating the enzyme. Whether the same phenomena is replicated in human pneumonocyte is not known, but definitely a food for thought. It has been seen that metformin and sulfonylureas, if tolerated, exhibits no interaction with either SC2 or ADAMS17 and probably can be safely continued if there is no problem at all. On the contrary, pioglitazone has been shown to upregulate SC2 in insulin-sensitive tissues in rats and reduce ADAMS17 activity in human skeletal muscles. But again, there are different some contradictory findings. So as of now, we cannot comment on pioglitazone and its positive or negative effects in type 2 diabetes patients who are at risk or co-infected with COVID-19. Next slide, please. The talk of the town is DPP-4 inhibitors and GLP-1 analogs, whether they can be beneficial in the outbreak of COVID-19 in type 2 diabetes patients, where I can share to you a mechanism that apart from breaking down circulating GLP-1, DPP-4 activates T cells, upregulates CD8 T6 expression, NF-kappa-B pathway, and thereby promoting inflammation. So we can understand that if we inhibit the DPP-4, then definitely it might prevent all this pathway. And there are some anecdotal reports showing that there is increased risk of nasopharyngitis and UTI, while again others have negated this finding. So at present, although SARS-CoV-19 does not reduce or does not have a potential anti-inflammatory role, but regarding the use of DPP-4 inhibitor, which has a long matter of question, but again, it probably modulates the inflammatory pathway, and in the theory and practical, of course, might differ. Nonetheless, at this point of time, we could not see an evidence that DPP-4 inhibitor do not alter or modulate the SE2 expression as shown in diabetic mice. Although rarely used in routine diabetic practice, but the burning topic today because of the cheap availability of hydroxychloroquine, as our previous speaker has mentioned, it remains a good choice under present circumstances. Of course, there are some reports and other things has shown that there are a few scattered case reports of increased cardiovascular morbidity in the risk of increased QTc interval. Next slide, please. So again, we have to say that those who are on insulin therapy, the target blood sugar should be ideally to be kept at in between 110 to 180 milligram per DL. Of course, this might vary from guidelines like ADA or ASC, but as of IDF guideline we are following, we should be on this target. But again, if the blood glucose level stays persistently above 180 milligram per DL, we can understand that we have to increase the insulin dose, and accordingly, we can check at least 4 hours, 4 hour intervals, subjected to the availability of the glucometer strips. And if possible, if the patient is having ketone body positive, then we can monitor a bit more frequently, 1 hourly or 2 hourly. Next slide, please. So having said that, we have to see that definitely the FDA has given approval. They have exported, imported, India has exported a lot of amount of hydroxychloroquine, and we feel proud ourselves regarding we have exported hydroxychloroquine to so many countries. And of course, there are controversy exists. There are guidelines from FDA, there are guidelines from ICMR. By now, the learned audience has already seen all this the discussions and other things. Even the social media also was active regarding the use and adverse effect, because many of our physicians and diabetologists has been already practicing for autoimmune diseases like different form of SLE and other disorders. So definitely there is evidence, and definitely there are some recommendation, but again there are some scattered case reports on increased cardiovascular morbidity. So it of course I'll just keep it on you for your choosing a right amount and the right dose of hydroxychloroquine. Next slide, please. So friends, I think I should not go much detail to on this because we have an almost hour of long discussion. We just want to share you a few points that almost about 10% of the COVID-19 patients probably have diabetes as of today. As from different studies, we can see globally, and till today, we can see that if the blood sugar is in strict control, the diabetes probably does not pose increased risk for SARS-CoV-19 infection, but definitely promotes severe progression in COVID-19 patient. And in poorly glycemic control patient, diabetes has got an increased risk of mortality. Therefore, we have to understand that this is a definite challenge, management of diabetes and glucose management when they are co-impacted or at risk for COVID-19 patient. Probably in the inpatient management, the basal bolus regimen and in the severe cases, IV infusion with strict glycemic control and strict glycemic monitoring and avoidance of patient lending to diabetic ketoacidosis and the prevention of the cytokine storm with the judicial use of the antiviral drugs, we can combat the situation. Friends and colleagues, thank you for patient care. These are few suggested links, of course.
The short question answer session. The first question I will direct to Dr. Noni Gopal Singh. It is from Noni. Are you hearing me?
Yeah, I'm online.
Yeah, it's a question from Dr. B.C. Kolita from Assam Medical College, Dibrugarh. Is there any record of orofecal transmission?
Okay, Dr. Vipul Gunta, probably I mentioned already there is no evidence of fecal transmissions. No doubt the virus found to be both RN and the live virus found to be the stool specific, even they may persist for quite a long time because, but this has not still been proved that there can be a fecal route can occur, infection can occur. Even this has been challenged in MacQuays by putting intranasal. But they did not found to be have the more chance infection or they did not get any infection. So as of now, there is no role, no evidence of recurrent.
Thank you, Dr. Noni. Next question is from Dr. P.C. Thakur, also from Dibrugarh. What is the prophylactic medicine for fairly controlled diabetes likely to come into contact with a COVID patient? Either Dr. Sanjeev or Mukut Roy, please.
As of now, as I have told, the prophylaxis is only chloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine is better. 400 milligram, the dose I have already told, 400 milligram step, followed by weekly dose. 400 milligram followed by weekly dose for in case of healthcare professional for 7 weeks and for normal persons less than that. So chloroquine can be given. That is the only prophylaxis which is available as of now.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with Dr. Sanjeev Medhi, what he has mentioned, because hydroxychloroquine probably is the answer. And we have used hydroxychloroquine in the diabetes patient earlier as a matter of anti-hyperglycemic agents.
Thank you, Dr. Mukut Roy. As we are very short of time, I'll go first. Next question is directed to Dr. Noni, please. What is your opinion regarding risks of metabolic syndrome patients with COVID-19? There is a recent publication in a reputed journal which shows odd ratio of 10. It is question from Avik Chakraborty Agartala. Please be brief in your answer. Okay. Dr. Noni, please.
Hi, Dr. Avik. Thanks for the questions. And you are very right. And in the metabolic syndrome with the diabetes, it has been seen that the cases are severe and the recent publication has proved that 10 times more higher than the non-metabolic people. I think you have put the question very right way, and it is true as of now.
Then another question, when RT-PCR is negative in the first sample, then a second is to be retested. When is the second retest to be performed? At the same time, you say the test result could be still negative as antibody builds up. Then what is the point of doing the second retest? From Yang Kong.
Dr. Govinda said RT-PCR initially can be negative. We have seen that the positivity specificity is quite less. And if you from the nasal sample, the positivity rate is around 63%. So it is quite obvious we might get around 30% people with the negative. But if the symptom persists and if the suspicious is there, you can retest after 5 to 7 days. If not, also you can retest after 14 days. But one should keep in the mind, RT-PCR test in the first week is almost 100% positive. At gradually advances, the positivity rate goes down. In the second week, it becomes 90%. and third week it becomes around 60%, and by 6 weeks when the patient recovers, it becomes negative.
Another question from Dr. Midul Das from Agartala again. To Dr. Singh, recently in Tripura, two BSF persons came to Tripura, kept in a quarantine, tested as negative, sent to border post, and after 42 days, they developed sign symptoms, tested positive, now under treatment. Please explain.
Well, Dr. Midul says this is now the cases going on, and the when there is epidemic, the pandemic ends, probably will be rightly we can answer this, that how what is actually a right incubation period. I have shown in one of my slides that CDC has put a footnote that out of 101, out of 10,000 patients can present after the days of 14 days. You never know, this case may be, this may be the example of your case, or this may be, they may be remaining asymptomatic for sometimes as a carrier, they might, later they might develop the symptoms. That is the only explanation which I can put forward in front of you. And the rest, I don't have any explanation. Thank you.
Another question to Dr. Sanjeev Medhi, maybe the last question or second last, is from Dr. Pranab Kumar Vishwas, Guwahati. What is the role of ivermectin in treatment of COVID-19?
Ivermectin is the drug to be watched in the future. It is the only drug which has shown the highest mortality benefit. 0.0004 is the p-value of the trial. So this is the drug which has shown the highest mortality, but the dose which we use is very high. So that needs to be calibrated. Trials are going on, but this is a drug to be watched in the future.
Yes, I have a comment, Dr. Barua, and this actually probably somewhere I missed also in the disease, the male are more affected than the female, and the more mortality is seen in the male than the female. That's I missed one point. In the management part, I don't know if I miss it. In the management, probably the prone position is sometimes helpful in the ICU setup, and yes. And which is also opined by the Dr. Devamalla, and they are having right now one patient under them, and they have seen the improvement on the prone positioning. This is one of the
That comment has been given by Dr. Devamalla Bhuya also, this prone position with the with the lung involvement with steroid and other things.
Anyway,
we will not discuss much on this. Next question is, there has been a contraindication, is from Dr. David Tarian from Shillong. There has been contradicting report on the use of hydroxychloroquine. What is the latest evidence as to use or not to use? Anecdotal reports on fewer people who are already on HCQs for some other conditions are getting infected by COVID-19. What is your opinion, Dr. Sanjeev Medhi, please?
See, chloroquine is a very safe drug. We are using this drug for over a long period of time. We are also using it as an anti-diabetic, as an anti-hypoglycemic drug. But the caveat is that there should be no blanket cover for each and every patient. The patient needs to be monitored. A baseline ECG has to be done. Any conduction defect in the heart, better to avoid it. Any QTC prolongation, better to avoid it. And once you start this drug, it's always better to monitor the QT interval.
Another question is to Dr. Sanjeev Medhi. Any data about the use of antivirals in India and results of COVID-19 cases? What treatment protocol used in Assam?
All the patients are very mild patients in Assam. So we have all the patients, as far as my knowledge goes, all the patients have responded to chloroquine only. And remdesivir is being used in other parts of India, but it's a very costly medicine. The cost comes to around ₹1 lakh for 7 days course. Ritonavir and this lopinavir combination is also costly, but those drugs are used. But in Assam, no patient has been given all these medicines. Only chloroquine has done the job.
Thank you to all panelists. As due to the paucity of time, I have to wind up here. At present, I am thankful to the all participants who have participated from all the states of the Northeastern region and took active participation. And lastly, before leaving, I should pay my thanks to the Juventus Lifestyle Division. Their VP is Mr. Anit Ghosh, and their divisional sales manager, Mr. Uttam Sharma. They have of great help from the very beginning, and a special thanks to Mr. Siddharth and team for organizing the webinar nicely. Thank you all again. Thanks to all panelists and thanks to all participants.
Thank you.
Thank you.